Hey, what's up, YouTube? Hey, if you've taken a class, like any class in the last 5-10 years, you are probably already familiar with the concept of the trigger warning. Now, to those who maybe aren't in the know, let me explain. A trigger warning is when you're about to hear a lecture in an academic field, like history or literature, or you're about to read a work, like let's say it's Huckleberry Finn or something like that. And a trigger warning is an official, very often stated on the syllabus, the very syllabus of the class itself, is an official warning that you are likely to be offended by what you're about to read or hear or encounter. It may be something that is antiquarian, like a practice, like slavery. It may be a terminology that you do not like. For instance, the use of gender-specific pronouns instead of the new transgender pronouns that some universities are trying to put into effect. It may be the perspective of the author, and that, for instance, maybe he is alleged to defend the patriarchy or something like this. And so a trigger warning is official warning to students that they are right and liable to actually be inflamed, upset, angry, frustrated by what they've read. And so a trigger warning is sort of a cue to students that they're likely going to be upset by what they're about to encounter in this class, this lecture, book, essay, something from the past, whatever it is, historical artifact, idea, philosophy. It's going to be offensive. And so it's preparing students right off the bat to be offended, to think emotively, to think from a position of fear or anger or resentment or frustration. Now, in as much as everybody seems to be using the trigger warning lately these days in colleges and universities, I do have a question as to whether or not that's even a good idea. Is thinking essentially a emotive or affective process, or should there be something more rational? Should there be something more intellectual? Should we evaluate these types of literature or historical ideas or precedents with some sort of a cooler, rational process? And what I'd like to suggest today in this very short video is that absolutely we reject the trigger warning, effective, emotive analysis process, and instead replace it with something which is older, and I think far more effective, and that would be logic. That's right, logic, thinking with the mind. It used to be in the days that we actually taught courses called logic or clear thinking. I remember one of the most important classes I took in college at Malone University. It was called Malone College back in those days. We had a class called critical and creative thinking, wherein we learned to spot fallacies in arguments, fallacious arguments. If you ever read C.S. Lewis's book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, The Chronicles of Narnia, there's a place where the professor actually laments. He says, don't they teach logic in the schools anymore? Well, would that we did teach logic in the schools these days, because what is logic other than the intellectual ability to appraise an idea coolly and rationally from the mind and to dispense what is unpersuasive in that particular argument? So for instance, if you were to study logic, you would come across the concept of the informal fallacy. Now, a formal fallacy is something much more mathematical. It's an error in the calculus of the argument, so to speak. But informal fallacies are slid into argumentation all the time. And when you learn to spot them out, then you can eat up an essay or a chapter or an article like a watermelon and spit out the seeds that are non-persuasive. We should not be persuaded by everything that we read. We should not be persuaded by everything that we hear. And logic is the science of being able to evaluate an argument based on its persuasive ability alone. So for instance, let me just give you a couple examples here. Logic helps us to identify such things as circular reasoning. Now in circular reasoning, what you're trying to do is you're trying to prove the very assumption that you started with. So let me give you kind of an example. If somebody said, hey, the Pope is infallible. All right, well, there's a truth claim, isn't there? Well, how do you know the Pope is infallible? Well, because he says so. There it is. Well, that would be an evidence of circular reasoning. You're trying to prove the very thing that you're assuming from the get-go. And so circular argumentation is not regarded logically as being very persuasive. Now, that's a pretty obvious example, but we use informal fallacies, unfortunately, all the time, especially in our political discourse. So you'll have something like an ad hominem informal fallacy, which is where you attack the person rather than defeating intellectually the argument that they're making. It's far easier to just insult somebody than it is to actually put down the cogency of their particular idea or philosophy. That's much harder to do. Okay, so that's an ad hominem when we simply attack somebody. Well, trained students should be able to recognize ad hominem arguments and reject them. What's so hard about that? Ad populum arguments, similar thing. An ad populum informal fallacy is where you simply appeal to what's popular. Well, 80% of the people in America think that this is right. Okay? Well, 80% of the people could very easily be wrong. And so I'm not convinced just by the numbers of sheer population persuasion alone. I don't find that to be a cogent, rational, convincing argument. Okay, and there are others. Straw man argument is simply where you diminish a person's intellectual force because you don't want to have to deal with it. So instead, you truncate their argument, you make it easier to refute, and then you demolish it, usually in an insulting or condescending way. Well, there's 20 or so informal fallacies, and when you learn to recognize them as a student, then you can read something that challenges you without having to react emotively. You're going to get triggered on this. You're going to feel anger, students, and we need to protect the university as a safe learning environment. Well, listen, if you want to make the university a safe learning environment, dispense with the trigger warning nonsense and teach the kids how to think, for goodness sakes. We should go back to the ancient ways of the logicians, being able to understand, appreciate, articulate, and refute arguments as they come to us based on the merits of the idea alone and quite apart from any emotive force that it's going to have behind it, much less any emotive reaction that it's supposed to stir up in my soul. Okay? So there you go. There's a few thoughts for you. If you are interested in logic, man, there's a lot of great books on logic out there. I would advise you to go ahead and do some research on that topic. By the way, I just as part of my parenting, I created 125 PowerPoint slides on logic that I subjected my children to because I knew they weren't going to get it in the schools. They're not going to teach it in the schools. So I taught my children logic. We did it on the Lord's Day over a course of several months. I just went through all the PowerPoints, taught my kids how to think. Now they recognize informal fallacies all the time. When they see commercials on TV, for instance, or they hear political arguments, they're able to recognize these things. Thinking people should be able to recognize and to refute argumentation without being emotionally overrun by them. All right, thanks for checking in. Love you lots. Talk to you later.